So back to the question of what a research clinic needs. You need a room for the study coordinator. Okay, you need enough space for at least one, maybe two study coordinators to work. You need some cabinets, locked cabinets preferably, where you're going to be putting the study records, like the source documents, the reg binders. What I like best, and not all of my clinics have it yet, because a lot of them are still in the startup phase, is those built-in wall cabinets, because they take up less space, because they're actually built into the wall. They cost probably like $3,000 to $5,000 for probably four big cabinets. They go from floor to ceiling. So in one cabinet, just to give you an idea, you could probably fit about three or four studies. So if you have like four of these, you've got enough for, you know, 13 to 16 trials. That's what I like. They take less space. They're locked. Sponsors want to see double locked. That means that the cabinets can lock and the door to get into that room locks too. Then you need a dedicated room for the monitors. So it's got to be separate from where the coordinators are, because monitors like to have a private, quiet place where they can work. And it's really in your best interest to have them in a quiet, private area where they can work, because if they're in a place where they're distracted, they can't focus on the data in front of them and reviewing the visits, you're probably not going to get paid as quickly as you would like. And that's bad for any business. So you need a coordinator room, you need a private monitoring room. A reception area would be nice to have the patients wait until the study coordinators are ready to start the study visit. You would probably need a physician's office, if you have it, where the PI can come and see the patients. And it obviously should be private, and ideally this is the place or the room where the informed consent will take place, as well as most of the PI study participant interactions. Then the very important one is the investigational product room. So it needs to be temperature controlled 24/7. This has to be double locked too. So limited access. Only a few people can enter the IP room, the investigational product room. It should be locked. Inside, you should have another locked cabinet for the IP, and it should be temperature controlled. So you gotta really, like, some of these offices in different parts of the country can get very hot or very cold. And I know a lot of landlords out there, they like to turn off the utilities after business hours, because in those buildings, if the landlords are paying the utilities, they obviously want to save money. Well, you can't have that at your research clinic. The temperature usually has to be between 55 and 77 degrees Fahrenheit, although I've seen lower lows and higher highs than that, but that's on average between 55 and 77 is what the IP room should be. So if you're in Arizona in the summer and the landlord cuts off the utilities after 5, hey, it's gonna get to like 90 in that room, if not higher. So your IP is now tainted. You can't use it. It's an excursion. It's called a temperature excursion. It's a process. It's a long process. It's gonna give you a lot of headaches. You've gotta send all the IP back, quarantine it all. Then you have to wait for a sponsor to send you new IP. So you want to save yourself that hassle and either work something out with your landlord or get like your own generator or something so you can keep the utilities on and keep those temperatures within range. You also should have set up some kind of notification, like some kind of alarm should go off if temperature is like too low or too high, so that you'll know when an excursion has taken place. And they should be recording constantly, even on the weekends and holidays. So even if your staff's not at the clinic, it's still recording. And then on Monday or whenever you come in back to the office, you can get a reading for what the temperature was for the time that no one was in the clinic. So temperature control, drug room. You'll need an exam room where you can draw blood, do ECGs, vital signs, all that kind of stuff. Then you need a room where you can process the labs that you just drew. So you'll need like a centrifuge, sometimes you need a refrigerated centrifuge, you need a sink, you need access to water. Also a restroom, obviously, if you're collecting urine samples from the patient, it's probably nice to have a bathroom to send them to. So that's a must. I know a lot of offices have shared bathrooms, and there's ways that this can work, but if you're gonna have high volume of study participants and you're in a big building where there's a lot of tenants, might be a problem. If you're in a smaller building with not so many tenants, you can probably get away with it. So in a nutshell, that's what you need. You also need a lot of extra space for storing lab kits as they come in, shipping boxes. You're gonna get like so many shipments for each protocol. You'll get way more than you can imagine you'll be receiving. So you need more space than you probably think you need. A good starting point is like 1600 square feet on the low end. If you have a 1600 square foot office with all of the rooms that I just discussed, you can probably do about 8 to 12 studies, and you could probably have one or two coordinators for that. Obviously, if you go into a bigger space, you're gonna have more studies. So I've seen some clinics that have like 5,000 square feet. And then if you get into the phase one inpatient units, where they have like an outpatient part, like an outpatient wing, and then they have like another wing that's just for inpatient studies, where basically staff is like 24/7 and study participants are staying overnight. Obviously you need a dedicated space for that, and it's a little more involved there because they have PK, pharmacokinetic, blood draws, sometimes every 10 minutes, sometimes every 5 minutes. So you definitely need more space there, and you need to also entertain the study participants if they're there that long. Same thing in the outpatient studies. You have some visits. We have one protocol where the study participants have to stay for 12 hours on a particular day. So you need to give them something to do. It'd be nice to have a TV or Wi-Fi for them to just not get bored if they're going to be there that long. If you have the space, especially those phase one units, they have beds. You can have a room where they can take a nap. In an outpatient clinic, you may not have that option, but I know in some of the larger clinics, you guys do. So that's basically, in a nutshell, what a research clinic should look like. Okay, so hopefully that helps. I got another question. It was in regards to things you can invoice on a contract. So let's say you get a study, you negotiated the contract. Well, before you finalize that contract, make sure you negotiate these things in advance: recruitment reimbursement, transportation reimbursement, study archiving reimbursement, and a pharmacy fee. Okay, and there's a lot of other things you do want to negotiate too, like an indemnification for your investigator. There's a whole lot of other stuff, but just from the financial stuff, that's what you want to do. So, and these things are good because you get them like either right away, so like the advance, the startup payment, you'll get as soon as your site is initiated, which is usually the case. The pharmacy fee, look, even if you don't have a pharmacy, you can still invoice for a pharmacy fee. If you have an IP room, the one I just described, guess what? It costs money to maintain that room. It's not free to have someone checking on the temperature every single day and making sure that the temperature is within range. Invoice for your pharmacy fee. Usually that's $500, $1,000. I've seen that for $2,000. Study archiving. This is getting more expensive, especially now with a lot of these European sponsors. Their requirements are 25 years that the research site has to keep the records, or the investigator has to retain the records until they can be destroyed. 25 years. That's a long time. So you need to negotiate probably $2,000 for that, if not more. Actually, I wouldn't think it was ridiculous to ask for $5,000. I haven't tried this yet. Usually I see like $2,000 or $2,500. But as these fees start getting higher, you actually got to plan for inflation and account for inflation, especially if we're talking 25 years. We don't know what can happen, all right? We saw what happened in 2008 with the recession we had. I mean, a lot of economists that I pay attention to and watch are saying that we can expect a few more of those in the next 25 years. So plan accordingly. Ultimately, it's the investigator's responsibility. And I don't know too many companies that even survive that long. So if your company dissolves, you can actually send your study records back. But sometimes the sponsors won't allow it, although for the most part they do. I've just gone through this with one of my sites. So most of the sponsors took the study records back, but some said, hey, you got to keep them, but we're willing to pay you X amount of dollars to do it. So in that case, we didn't want to, but we ended up doing it and we got some money. So it should cover the storage costs. So those are the things you want to invoice for. Sometimes to give sites a greater incentive to get started, they do a rapid document turnaround. So usually like they'll give you $1,000 or $1,500 bonus if you can get all the regulatory docs returned within like 2 weeks from when you receive them. So that's another thing you want to stay on top of your coordinators for. So those are the financial things I would talk about and that I would negotiate in my contract and budget. And what else? There was one more topic. It's this whole move to get all the regulatory stuff and all the even source documents stored electronically. So I think we're a good 5 to 10 years away from this, but it's very similar to the CRF. Okay, when I first started in this industry in 05, we were just starting to switch to electronic CRFs. But then now, in 2015, most of our studies are eCRF. Very few, if any, are still using paper. So the same thing I think is happening with the site reg binders, source documents, and they're integrating this with remote monitoring and risk-based monitoring. So the idea is if we can put these documents in a secure cloud, which there are companies out there, there are vendors that do this, and sponsors are actually starting to pay them to do this, you'll have the documents. So you'll still have the source documents at your site, but you're going to scan these things and they're going to be in the cloud. And then the idea is that monitors don't necessarily have to come to your site anymore to monitor. They can just look at these documents on the cloud. And same thing with any auditor, like the FDA can actually look at these documents instead of actually coming to your site. And then the idea is that the monitor will focus on issues pertaining to that particular protocol. So if in one study, a lot of study participants are getting rashes, the monitors can focus on that. Or if in one study, a lot of sites are making protocol deviations on one part of the study, the monitors can focus on that instead of kind of just like looking at everything. So that's how remote monitoring and risk-based monitoring is going to integrate with electronic documents, basically. And it's going to happen. It's going to happen probably faster than we think, but I predict in 5 years or so that we're going to have all of our source docs still with us. So you're still going to need those cabinets I talked about, but you're also going to be scanning these things and they're going to be on a server, and your monitor is actually going to look at those things and not your paper ones. The paper ones are going to be for you at the site, but you're also going to scan these things. And same thing with the reg binder, reg documents. Instead of wasting money on FedEx and harming the environment by like making copies of redundant documents so that everyone can have a copy, they'll just be scanned, stored in the cloud. This is where I see things going. I've just had talks with someone who's pretty high up at one of these companies, and he basically said, this is the way we're going, this is why we're going there. And the interesting thing he told me was that the only thing keeping the sponsors from completely adopting this right now, believe it or not, is the research clinics. So the sponsors are worried that there's going to be a lot of resistance from the research clinics, which there is, because right now, who wants to scan all this stuff? So they got to figure out a better way to do it and a way that will make the research clinics happy. And I think one way is to reduce the monitoring visits to the site, because those usually are stressful at the worst and just kind of redundant after a while, especially if you're a high enrolling site. you're pretty much going to have to get used to your monitor coming every 3 weeks, every 5 weeks. This might reduce that, so this might give sites the incentive to want to adopt this cloud storage for source, regulatory, all that stuff. So anyways, that's enough for this podcast, but keep your questions coming. Dan at theclinicaltrialsguru.com. Thanks for watching and take care.